Oops.
Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind. Smiles we gave to one another.
This is the Rewind Project. I am Eric.
I'm Stacey.
And we are once again joined by my friend Patrick Nelson.
Yay!
Hello, everybody.
Hey, Patrick. And we're here today to talk about the feel-good movie of 1969.
It really was.
It made me feel good.
The first X-rated film to ever win Best Picture.
Yes.
It's not X-rated anymore. They rejiggered the ratings once they figured out what was going on. But, you know, the Hays Code had just gone away. We're familiar with the Hays Code?
Tell me more.
The Hays Code was... I learned all about the Hays Code watching a documentary called The Celluloid Closet, which is a fabulous... A little dated now because it's kind of, you know, back in the 90s. But all about how LGBT people were represented on screen. I'm kind of surprised that Midnight Cowboy didn't make it into The Celluloid Closet because, boy, we're going to talk about that. But the Hays Code was this list of things that you could not do in the movies, because actually in the 30s,
you could
movies were going
anything.
Crazy. They had orgy scenes. There was a Caligula that was made in the 30s
and there were no rules.
The studio self-imposed these rules.
Because the government was threatening to start putting some rules on them, and they decided to do it themselves.
Hays of the Hays Code was this little senator, this little weaselly guy who said, here's all the things you're not allowed to put in movies. And one of them was sexual perversion, which basically meant any notion of gay people whatsoever.
Anything other than the missionary position.
And you couldn't even show that.
It was
very strict. And so The Celluloid Closet, this is a little bit of a rabbit hole, but interestingly kind of showed how people got around the Hays Code. Well, Midnight Cowboy is made after the Hays Code went away. And now the floodgates were open. You could put anything on screen again.
And they tried.
Yes, they really did. Mm-hmm. So this was a film directed by John Schlesinger. Mm-hmm. Written by Waldo Salt, based on a novel by James Leo Herlihy. So while Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, which is the first episode in this, that one for Best Original Screenplay, this one for Best Adapted Screenplay. It also won Best Picture, Best Director, acting nominations for Dustin Hoffman, John Voight, and Sylvia Miles. So let's get into the plot of this, shall we?
My arms are crossed and probably will be for the duration.
She's very standoffish on the other side of the table today.
This is a movie
about... Don't be offended. It's not you.
I am not.
About a young man named Joe Buck.
Where's Joe Buck?
Joe Buck came from Texas. He travels to New York with dreams of being a hustler, a gigolo,
a male prostitute
for women. He's very clear on that.
Very clear.
He wants to...
Because he's not an F word. Did you guys count how many times? And I don't mean the word fuck, because I don't have a problem saying that.
Did you count how many
goddamn times that word was said?
I ran out of fingers.
Yeah.
It was horrifying.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was, believe me, very much of its time. And
three letter word, or it's a six letter word if you do the whole one.
Yes.
It's awful. It was awful. It's also
drag or maggot.
It's also the name for a cigarette over in the UK.
Yes.
Yes. And my mother.
Or a bundle of sticks.
And you see these people smoking fags, and I'm like, wait, what?
Yeah. So that was a very popular word in this film. But Joe was not one of those. Joe was a man who wanted to go have sex with rich women and get rich.
Yep.
Doing that. And he really thought that he could make a whole bunch of money.
Do it in New York.
And standing around 42nd Street dressed like a cowboy, that rich women were just going to walk up to him.
And that is literally the plot. That is what...
That's everything.
Was trying to happen.
Well, and it's a movie. It is a movie about a relationship, although, you know, Dustin Hoffman is very much the second banana in
this.
Can I
just say something? I promised, because during, I forget which movie it was, I kept saying, it's so 1969. So I'm not going to say that because I promised I wouldn't. But I just want to say late 60s, early 70s. And again, some of it is the Hayes thing going away. But some of it is just where society was. Oh, my God, with the realism. Oh, my God, with the nitty gritty. Everything's dirty. I mean, oh, sweet Jesus. He's the very beginning. He's trying to get, you know, he's getting out of Texas. He's, you know, getting everything. First of all, I did love his suitcase of cowhide.
Yes,
that was awesome. But everything else was ridiculous. But it was everything was so disgusting. And I want to say this through 100% of this movie.
Yes. Yeah. And I want to add one more. Oh, my God. It's like, oh, my God, the character development. The entire movie was character development.
Yep.
Well, that was true. It must have been something about
that. Was true the last time you spoke to us about Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice.
It's an actor's dream.
That was true about Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid.
But
she's about to explode.
Butch Cassidy was entertaining.
But we talked about the fact that there was lighter on plot, bigger on revealing.
It was
character.
All about the people. Yeah. And I do think. Clearly, there was a theme in 1969, but I'm going to say 1968 through about 72. Yeah. Movies were doing this, and they were trying to do creative ways. And this in Schlesinger, what's his name?
Yep, John Schlesinger.
Yeah. He did some creative stuff, didn't he? We didn't have a lot of, we had some things that were not chronological. We had real shortcuts and weird editing happening. The idea of psychedelic. It felt like maybe we were all on psychedelic drugs.
Then at the end, they went to that Warhol party and smoked that wacky tobacco and had a good time. So he develops a friendship with this guy named Salvatore.
Once he gets to New York,
and just gets taken advantage of over and over and over. And he's such a rube. And just everyone cheats him out of all of his money. He's broke before long at all. And one of the guys who robs him blind is a guy named Salvatore Rizzo, who like in Greece, actually, who goes by Ratzo only because one of the charming gay men that we meet in this movie is a guy wearing a lime green blouse.
Not a cliche at all.
No, not at all. Not a bit. Although I'm sure that actor was probably a young gay man living in New York who basically just kind of came in and played himself.
He pulled shit out of his own wardrobe. Yeah. We don't know.
And I am 100% sure that the character Ratzo is the inspiration for the Muppet Rizzo. You know, the little rat Rizzo.
Yeah.
I bet you're absolutely right
because he is that kind of, you know,
they have the same accent and they're tiny little ratty people.
I never put those two together.
Because I enjoy
the Muppets. That's why.
Oh, my God. I love the Muppets, too. Like, the whole...
I know, but I'm just saying, I didn't put anything that was enjoyable with this movie.
I saw it right off, as soon as I saw
you
Dustin
are clever.
Hoffman.
You've just blown my mind.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I think I'm sure you're right.
And
Jim Henson were alive.
He's so smart. He was so smart, though. And, of course, he pulled shit from places that kids wouldn't know. Because it didn't really matter. Who cares if it's from Midnight Cowboy that was rated
maybe
X?
Maybe 10 years later?
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yes, you're exactly.
He was?
Yes, you're exactly
That's
right.
That's awesome. We had an update.
Frank just Googled it, and it's true.
Oh, that is so funny.
So, Patrick, you blew my mind, and you impressed the world.
Hey.
Because the world listens to us, don't
my
they,
15
Eric?
Minutes are up.
You keep telling me they do. Oy vey. But yeah, it was a gritty.
Can I describe the plot of this movie?
Didn't we do that already?
No.
Oh my God. So, it's not that long a plot.
Yeah, it's not. But I mean, basically, the whole thing becomes about this friendship and how they actually, you know, after they get over the whole fact that he, you know, robbed him out of $20, they meet again and kind of travel this lonely, dirty road together. And that's the plot.
Here's what I'm going to say. One thing before we get completely to New York. On the bus ride from Texas to New York, which basically I feel like we did it in real time.
Yes. And the one to Miami at the
last. Oh, my God.
Well, I'm listening to that song over.
Oh, my God. The song. Oh, I also have a comment about it. But first, I want to say about John Voight himself, the way that it was filmed and the lighting and everything, and the fact that John Voight was pretty young in 1969, I saw a lot of it. I've never seen, I've been like, okay, you tell me that Angelina Jolie is his daughter, but they don't look at all alike. They do in this movie. Oh, I saw when in his young face, I'm like, holy shit. That's Angelina Jolie as a guy.
Mm-hmm. Those are Angelina Jolie's lips.
They sure as hell were.
They certainly were.
They sure as hell were. She has not had anything done to those because John Voight gave them to her. There's that. But also, here's what I'm going to say. 1969, the movies that we've seen, almost all of them have at least one iconic song that has come out of them, mm-hmm. which tells you in some of the reviews that were done, people were, Roger Ebert said, oh my God, all these movies come out with, can we have one movie that doesn't have some song in it that is, but apparently that's not true. That's that we had to every, that was a big thing that filmmakers were doing is
but
that
it didn't
you had
seem
a song.
Like, in the 80s,
this one they kept
in
doing
the 80s.
Over over.
It felt like though, like we wanted really good soundtracks. And so you packed a lot of great songs. Yeah.
This
the
one is just, you have a song.
Cause remember we talked before about when we did our whole 69 preview, this movie, The Sterile Cuckoo, which came out this year, which was Liza Minnelli. As a young girl, and there was a song called Come Saturday Morning that they played over and over, so many montages, and always that same song. And this one, Everybody's Talking by Henry Nielsen.
Yeah, this song, I heard that way too often.
Oh, too many times.
Tonight. In this movie, it was too many times. And then there's one song at the end as well. It was a different song, wasn't there? Another song in this movie that was okay.
I forgot. I don't remember.
It doesn't matter. But anyway, I know that Everybody's Talking. They played it too much.
Yeah, yeah.
They played it a lot.
So let's walk through the cast. We just talked about John Voight as
one of the things that always bothers me about movies like 69 movies versus today is the money calculation. You know, we're talking about $20. $20 didn't mean anything to me because it's like, oh, $20, that's a drink. But $20 in 1969 was about $140 in today's.
It could get you, I would say, two nights at some kind of, it was a shit motel, but it could get you two nights in under, you know, not in the snow kind of thing. So it could do a lot. But you know.
So as a hustler, $20 was a lot of money.
Yeah. Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And especially new in town and had a limited amount of cash in his wallet.
Right.
You know.
And he probably underestimated. And I'm sure he underestimated how much he needed. He was basing it on Texas prices. Right.
And
New
he
York.
Was broke in no time. So we've talked about John Voight as Joe Buck and how much he looked like Angelina. What did you think of his performance?
There were scenes where he was a brick. I saw literally nothing. And I'm like, what the hell, John? Then there were moments where there were scenes where I'm like, okay, you did a good job in that one. I believed you. I felt, you know, I could see emotion on you. But I was underwhelmed. But I didn't hate him.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't the worst thing in this movie. But
he wasn't.
No, there were so many bad things in this movie.
I'm feeling you there, but I kind of feel like he was the worst.
As I said, he was underwhelming to me, but you know, there were so many things I disliked about this movie. So, you know, next, you know, that's where I was. Yeah,
I felt like anybody that was blonde and blue eyed at the time could have probably played that part. Literally, it didn't matter who. Just
I don't fault him for that though. I think that in a lot of ways, Joe Buck is not the most exciting character on the page.
He's a stick figure.
He's just he just kind of stands there and things happen to him.
Sure, but again, you know, as yes, I get that a lot of stuff happens. He is a victim of a lot of stuff. I get that, but there were times when I just felt like he wasn't aware that he was being. That anything was going on. Mm-hmm. Not only was he not aware he was being victimized, but he wasn't aware anything. There was, it's like John wasn't in the scene.
Yeah.
Now, and I will, let me just preface this. I have respected John Voight and in other stuff he's done. I respect him. I don't like him.
He's terrible.
No, I don't. In real life, I don't like him either, but I'm saying on screen, he's not anybody I want to watch on screen. I don't find him attractive and I don't find him any kind of charming. So I don't have any kind of connection to him at all. Having said that, I do respect him in some of the roles he's taken on. He's very believable and he's real and I appreciate that. I don't in this one. And was it because it was one of his first? I don't know. But it, as I said,
we're going to talk at the end about some of the other actors who screen tested and some were even offered this role.
So it'll be interesting.
No, I mean, I don't think he was very well known.
This put him on the map.
That he really kind of did.
Yeah, this is
Dustin Hoffman was known. He was certainly famous for The Graduate. Yeah. Made a big splash, Oscar nominated performance in The Graduate. And then he made this little movie called Madigan's Millions that no one's ever heard of.
You showed me that picture. It looks awful.
It looks terrible. And this was like
G rated.
It's a G-rated comedy. Yeah.
It looks stupid as fuck.
Really dumb. But this was kind of his first kind of, you know, splashy thing after The Graduate. So the world knew him.
Yeah.
And the role he played in Madigan's Millions, what I could tell, was a buttoned up, wearing a suit, you know, kind of a. So this was a huge departure from anybody had ever seen Dustin Hoffman do.
The Graduate, which is his other big movie.
Yeah. The way he auditioned for this is that people weren't sure he could do it. Mike Nichols told him not to do it. He said, "Are you kidding? I just made you a huge star and you're going to throw it all away by playing this guy that everyone's going to hate." He wanted to do this because he wanted to show the world that he could do more than Benjamin from The Graduate. And he certainly can. Dustin Hoffman's a great actor.
Well, he's proven that over the decades.
But he really wanted to do it early. So he was convinced that they wouldn't accept him in this. And so he arranged to meet the person to audition with on a street corner. And he sat there in rags begging for spare change. And the guy thought he was stiffing him, and he'd been sitting there for 10 minutes. And finally he walked up and said, "I've been behind you this whole time." Just to prove that he could blend on this scuzzy kind of 42nd
Street. 1969.
Isn't that a great showbiz legend kind of story? Dustin Hoffman loves the fact that I just told that story. I'm sure, because he listens.
Hi, Dustin.
Yeah.
Sylvia Miles, Oscar nominated for an incredibly brief performance, not the shortest ever. I think it's like the sixth shortest performance ever to be nominated for an Oscar.
It was a very short performance, though.
Yeah. But it was six minutes long.
We got everything from happy and sex to
she ran the gamut, but that's Sylvia Miles. I expect nothing less from her. Was it Oscar worthy? Meh. But I mean, she did a good job.
I think she probably got kind of like swept up in the whole Midnight Cowboys. It was the Oscar bait, kind of thing. And so let's just like, you know, who else can we nominate? And so she was not. She played John Voight's first, what he thought was going to be a score, and then it just turned out to be, you know, whether she knew what was going on the whole time, I don't know. But when he asks her for money for having done the deed, she's offended.
Yeah.
And actually takes $20 from him. So that's kind of how that ends up, because he's pretty stupid. Brenda Vaccaro played Shirley.
She was so young to see her.
Cute. I know, she was adorable.
She was so young.
I loved seeing her in this.
She was adorable. She was absolutely adorable.
She's the first person in the credits after John Voight and Dustin Hoffman. And I was waiting, like, where's Brenda Vaccaro? It's towards the end of the movie that we see her.
Blink you miss her, man.
She makes her presence known once she shows up, but she doesn't show up until the very end.
It's the last third of the film. Sure.
About halfway through, I'm like, did I miss Brenda Vaccaro? Have we seen her? When she showed up, I'm like, oh my God.
She did a very, very good job.
She's fun.
Again, Oscar.
She didn't get nominated for this.
Oh, she didn't get nominated?
No. It's just Sylvia Miles. I'm not sure how to say his name. Is it MacGyver, like the TV show, or is it John MacGyver? It's MCGIVER. I don't know how to say that. I recognized him right away, and it's because I love the old Frank Sinatra, Angela Lansbury, Manchurian Candidate, and he played the good senator in that. And so I loved him in that. And he's completely different than this. He plays Mr. O'Daniel, who is the guy that Dustin Hoffman says, "Oh, you need a pimp. You should meet my friend, Mr. O'Daniel." So he gets $20
from him. He's been in 1,000 Disney movies.
Yes.
Character actor.
Yeah.
1,000 Disney movies.
And he ends up being this like Jesus freak with a glowing Jesus behind the thing. And all he wants to do is pray. So when, you know, when he asks him to get down on his knees, at first Joe Buck thinks he's asking something very different, and then they're all going to pray together, and he, you know, runs, and a great little tiny scene. And then finally, Barnard Hughes, who I know from this movie that I saw, because it was one of the few things that we had on tape as a kid. First Monday in October, he played the Chief Justice opposite Walter
Bernard
Matthau.
Bernard Hughes has been in so many great things. And this was him kind of youngish.
Yes. He won the Tony Award for Da, which then he made the movie with Martin Sheen, which that's probably his best work ever, if you've ever seen Da. Irish guy returns to Ireland and meets the ghost of his father, and they have lots of great conversations. And it's a great, great performance from him. He plays a guy named Townie, one of the three gay men in this movie. This one, a real cliche ridden mama's boy, full of shame, you know, just awful. Yeah. Anything else you want to add about Bernard Hughes as Townie?
No,
Patrick, you have a look on your face.
The only people I really knew from this movie were I don't have the movie background that the two of you do, but the top characters were really the ones that I could remember from, you know, my youth or seeing them in other pieces, particularly MacGyver. You know, he was in so many things, Disney movies, and
yep.
would show up on television as assorted random characters and.
Yeah, he was very, very.
Yeah,
very
you've good. Seen this face before.
Now, the one yeah. name that you didn't mention is Bob Balaban.
I was going to get to him later.
Sorry,
yeah,
sorry.
But he's not the cast list. But yeah, we can talk about him. This was his film debut.
It's a very small role, but it's significant.
Yes.
And it was one of those where I'm looking at him going, who is that guy? He looks familiar, but it's so young.
Yes.
I have not seen anything until Bob was at least in his 40s. I didn't.
And bald. And
bald.
Here he's got a head full of dark curly hair.
And so it was hard for me to figure out. I noticed. Yeah. I had to look it up.
Yeah.
And just this, this was such a gritty movie.
It was dirty.
And and I felt gross the whole time.
Yeah.
I will tell you, this movie, and again, it was this pre-70s where it's like, everybody, we want to show what is reality. We want to be true and honest. We're not going to be like the baby boomers who were lied to and, you know, all this shit, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Well, they were the baby boomers, my body, but it's like, it's this whole, let's be honest, let's be real. And so there's you see the nastiness of, you know, even the soup that at one point
Ratso
gets from Joe Buck. He gives him this soup and I'm like, don't drink that. That's disgusting. But of course, they're living in disgust.
Yeah.
But even in Texas, when if you recall at the very beginning, they had a guy washing dishes and he just swept the crap off the dish with his hands, his bare hand into the trash. And it was like, that was nasty. And I didn't get clean until after this movie was over. It was just so nasty. And so you bring up all these different characters and then, oh yeah. And what I do is I go to that scene and I'm like, ooh, that room was gross.
Well, even the characters that were well off, it didn't feel like
you
they
get
were
it.
Very
well,
clean.
You're in Sylvia Miles's apartment. I felt like I could smell the old perfume permeating from the old wallpaper.
It was just the only time.
And apparently this film was the first recorded use of the word scuzzy, which is a great word for this.
That's
movie.
Amazing. Because
I think dirty is the word.
It was
for this
just
movie.
So yeah. I felt
but
gross
this is the first
the
time anyone ever heard the word scuzzy.
Well, it
in
sure
this
is
movie.
Fuck lived up to that name. It was just I
the
just
only time I
gross.
Didn't feel that kind of was at Brenda Vaccaro's pad.
Yes,
she had a really cool swinging 60s pad and she was finally what he'd been looking for.
She was exactly
he'd been envisioning.
He was looking for. Yes.
Rich, bored housewives who wanted to pay a young stud to fuck him in the afternoon. That's what he wanted to be. That's what she was. And he gave it all up for his dear friend Ratso before he, you know, so let's save him from his tuberculosis death. It's interesting. Somebody, you know, I was reading some reviews of this before this show, and one person said this is basically La Boheme. Joe Buck is Rodolfo and basically Dustin Hoffman is Mimi. The girl with the object of his affection with the tuberculosis. And a lot of people actually do point to homoerotic undertones of their relationship.
Sure.
The main evidence of that is when Ratso's having a vision of what life could be like in Florida, and they're running, and he and John Voight is shirtless on the beach as they're running together.
Sure.
And it's framed as very much this kind of love story.
I don't think
thing.
There was any subtlety in the homoeroticism in this movie.
No.
I'm sure they thought it was subtle at the time, but you look at it now at 2019, and it's just like a hammer on the head. Bam, well,
also,
bam, bam.
Also, the use of the word faggot over.
Correct.
And over
yeah.
again.
The yeah, more you say that, more I don't believe you.
Yeah, yeah, it was a little too much.
It was too much. Yeah, way too much. Yeah. And it was way too much, quite frankly, even for being too much. You know what I'm saying? It's like, come on, script writer. We get it. Yeah. We get it. He is homophobic, and he probably is homosexual. And you've proved that because he said this a number of times. Now you can back off of saying it, and they never did.
No.
And it's like.
True. And you brought up.
There are more than words.
I'm sorry, just going back to that. You brought up La Boheme. All I could think of was Moulin Rouge.
Yeah, the heroin with tuberculosis.
As I said, it was.
Here's my question.
Okay.
Who is the target audience for the? Who do you think the target audience was for this movie in the mind of John Schlesinger? Was he truly? Because here's what he said.
The Academy Award Association.
Yeah.
Maybe
I'm serious as a fucking heart attack.
Okay.
It was not. It was not the moviegoer.
No, it wasn't.
Well,
no.
See, I kind of wondered.
Or it was the pretentious, pompous intellectual who wants.
See, I thought in a way he was making this movie in a sense for people who thought they were cultured, but lived in flyover country. And aren't we glad we're not those people? Like, it's just one of those. This is a tale of urban squalor that just is so gross. And I don't, you know, and New York used to be a lot grosser than it
but
is now.
But he got rated X. So there are a lot of those in flyover country who are not going to go see an X-rated movie.
That's true.
And why couldn't it be kind of the peeling back of the veneer in New York and Washington and L.A.? For those people that live in those cities,
yeah,
that this is what's going on, you know, just around the block.
Well, I said this during when we talked about Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice, that all those people. I don't remember as a group that it was an actor's dream to do those parts. This is an actor. This is a scene study. This is the character. Please. Would I do any of these characters? You bet your ass. Do I want to go pay and watch them? Hell no.
I think, and I also feel like there was a lot of new cinematic things that were happening.
Yes. Oh, we were learning about making films.
Flashbacks and the psychedelic-y things that were happening and the building collapsing.
Here's a favorite point. So he's walking. He's just gotten to New York and he's walking down the street and there's this dead businessman on the sidewalk.
I was wondering what was up with that too.
And nobody's around him. And I'm like, that's bullshit. Even in 1969, cops would be there.
And nobody explained it.
And
that bothers me still.
It was
24 hours later.
I just laughed and went, well, that was funny. It made no sense. It was a bad choice, but it made me laugh in 2019.
It was that stranger in a strange land. Oh, I guess this is the heartless city you've just moved
and on the street, everybody walking by.
Either dead or sleeping. We
but
never got any
even,
story.
But it wasn't a homeless guy. He was in a suit.
Was a businessman.
So it was like... And he was white. So it was like there would be someone doing something in 1969. There would be totally somebody. But there would have been somebody there helping him.
Yeah.
Okay, in 1969,
agreed.
He's a white man. There would have been somebody helping him. So that was weird. And again, it's the same. It's like the use of the F word in that it's like, are you new? And you just don't know. You don't know. So you're like, oh, I've heard that word. I think it. And so I'm going to use it. And it's like, what would if you're going to a big city, what would be? Well, what if, you know, they have dead people and they just don't clean them up? I mean, I don't even. It's like somebody didn't know the writer. Who's the writer again?
Waldo Salt.
Waldo. OK, well, we could talk about that name for a while. But I mean, come on, Waldo, go to a city and see what it's really like. Not just out of cliches. That was weird. That was very strange.
Well, Waldo's very upset as he listens to this, holding his Oscar that he won for writing this screenplay. Anyway, Yeah, I mean, you're right. I mean, it is kind of that was a weird moment. A lot of little weird moments like that in this whole thing. But yeah, I mean, I kind of looked at this in terms of what the target audience is, and I wondered if it was just like, let's really explore urban squalor.
So you do that, and you're talking about Brenda Vaccaro's party.
Yep.
That party felt fake to me. That party, it was so contrived. And I'm like, okay, I get that all of it. When we think of, say, Studio 54, uh-huh. and we have, I mean, there's video of that. And so then you, in our heads, we just kind of exaggerate that and go to this, oh, it must have been this way or this way or this way. That's what this felt like. Again, somebody who had never been there, but they're guessing.
And a lot is made in the reviews of the fact that Schlesinger is a Brit. And so this was his first American film, and he was kind of seeing New York from an outsider perspective, you know. And I heard a lot in the 80s about when Giuliani apparently cleaned up Times Square, and everyone kind of missed the old dirty, gritty Times Square. And I guess this is what that was. I tell you what, I prefer Times Square now, I have to say. If this is what an accurate depiction of what Times Square was, pass.
Well, I was just in New York not too long ago, and I saw no dead businessman on the sidewalk. I mean, it's... I this party even felt fake to me. Yep. It just felt over. It felt cliche.
I didn't believe for a moment that maybe Joe Buck might have been invited. Clearly, this was, you know, this brother and sister named Hansel and Gretel.
Oh,
by the way.
Oh my God, it was so.
You know
what? It was such a. I don't know anything about this, but I'm going to write it.
Yeah,
that's what I felt about it.
From the whole point where they did the photo and they were walked up to him, I was like,
it was like, who does that?
They wanted to bring characters together. Okay, I get that Joe Buck is kind of a character. Pathetic character. Yeah, I mean, this guy who dresses like a cowboy walking around New York.
We had already established he was one of hundreds.
Yeah.
Understand that.
Sure.
We, at one point, he recognizes that I'm dressing up like a cowboy to be unique. And then we see literally 15 other cowboy guys leaning against the wall with a cigarette doing their best James Dean. Yep. And it's like, oh, he just figured out that, oh, maybe I'm not as unique as I thought I was. And so by this time, I mean, come on, those cowboys, Hansel and Gretel, that was bullshit.
Listen, I'm not saying that they have great taste, but it was almost, and I'm saying barely conceivable, that he would have been invited. No way in the world Rats or Rizzo's getting into that party. That was one that was just like, you know, okay, that's not happening. But the idea, I think, behind that party, it felt fake to me too, because I just was like, why are we here? This does not belong in this movie.
But it
at
also
all.
Didn't. It's not how they really were. You're sitting here saying this is true New York with the grit and the dirt and the rats and the blah and the blah. And then you come and have these two randoms walk into a diner and say, cha-ching, and say, take a picture, say, you're invited. And then that's it. No, fuck you. You can't sit there and say that this is a realistic depiction. You can't do both, and that was my frustration, is that I'm like, no, you're not realistic, and that means if you're lying about this, then you're also lying with how god awful the New York, and again, for some people, New York is awful, and I get that, but
and still is.
I'm sure there were condemned buildings right next to Times Square, just like that, that people were squatting in. Yep.
But guess what? We don't make a lot of movies about it because it's disgusting.
I'll just kind of say, this was the first, they never made any movies about it before. And that's why this was so revelatory to a lot of people, is that we're actually going into a condemned building with squatters, which is not anything that people had made movies about.
But this wasn't a movie about how can we help these people.
No. But it was just, but here's their life.
Not even close.
And again, you know, Schlesinger said, I wanted to convey the compassionate mixture of desperation and humor I found in the people all around me. And I didn't see a lot of humor. I just thought it was kind of depressing.
I didn't laugh much at all.
So here's a question. Here's a question I had. What is Joe Buck's backstory? We got all of these weird psychedelic-y kind of flashbacky things. Two things about that really intrigued me, and I wondered why they were there and what the point was, if any. And I wonder if you have any ideas about this. Grandma Buck, first of all, the trampy grandma. She was listed in one of the reviews I read as Joe's trampy grandma. And I'm like, okay, she was dating. She was single. Mm-hmm. Trampy seemed a bit harsh, but okay.
No, but, I don't think so.
But was that like a, this weird incestuous thing? Like, what were we supposed to think was going on?
I don't know.
It was just supposed to be creepy. No, and that grandma just, was a tramp.
She entertained a lot of cowboys. She made a comment about her new boyfriend, mm-hmm. and that, you know, and you heard something about how, you know, she liked cowboys, plural. Mm-hmm. And there were some flashbacks where she has, there is Joe Buck on her lap in her bed. And her latest cowboy is there as well. So while that may or may not denote trampiness, it's certainly bad parenting, in my opinion, you know, to have your child, you know, or the child you're taking care of, there with your latest bimbo, because we don't know how long these guys stuck around. Yeah, we don't, we don't have any inclination. The implication is that they didn't, but I think that she did, from what I saw, it looked like she did the best she could. She didn't
best she wanted to.
Well, I don't think she was good at it. Not, I mean, no, I think she probably, not. You know, you, she didn't come necessarily. I mean, obviously her daughter, it's her grandkid. It's not her daughter. We don't know what her daughter, she clearly raised her poorly, I'm guessing.
Well, we saw these two women drop him off. And that's kind of one of the flashbacks was, you know, and I'm like, who are the two women? Are they sisters? Right. Are they?
One of them
was probably his mother.
Maybe. Or it was friends of the mother who said, yeah, the mom died from some venereal disease. So yeah, here
we have no idea.
But I mean, I guess I didn't. My feeling about the grandmother was that she did love him and did the best. And maybe you're right. The best she wanted to do.
But I kind of got the idea that we were supposed to get that he got the idea to be a gigolo because he had a trampy grandma. Like, there's this.
I can see that.
Him being badly raised was what led him down this
path. Well, I mean, if you go down the psychological thing of what did he see, if he saw a lot of that at a very early impressionable age and that was what he thought was a normal thing, then yeah, that's where he would go. I'm giving it a lot more depth than I think that this movie ever did. I don't think it was.
I got that, you know, these flashbacky scenes were supposed to be very. And the other one that I want to get into is Crazy Annie.
Let's hold on that.
Let's put a pin in that for a second. I do want to say that what was weird to me is, so he says my grandmother died and she didn't tell me.
Yeah.
At one point. And we see a flashback of him in a uniform, which means that he would have enlisted.
Military.
So here's my issue is that, so when he gets out of that, he says the only thing I was good at was sex. And I'm like, dude, you had to come out with some kind of skill out of the military. And that was my frustration, is that at that point I lost believability. Before that, I'm like, if you have no education and you're hanging out with these dumbass boys that we'll talk about, then yeah, I can see where you can say the only thing I know how to do is have sex. But if you've been in the military, you've learned something, you know, and you haven't been, you know, what is the bad discharge?
Dishonorable.
Dishonorably discharged. Then you've learned, you have at least one skill you've come out with that you could then turn into something that would make you money. So I was a little confused by that moment. And again, it just added to the frustration of the whole movie. But as far as the other one, the other
Crazy Annie
goes, oh, I know exactly what happened. Don't you know? You saw what happened.
Why don't you share your vision?
Share your vision. Okay. Because I'll tell you what some of my questions were.
Was that he hung out with this group of guys. They probably called themselves a gang, but they were just a bunch of idiots. And, you know, there's this pretty girl in town that they all follow sometimes, and they catcall her and whatever. And somehow he gets a date with her, and they're having sex. Was it her first time? I don't know, but she was clearly infatuated with Joe. And so she keeps saying, it's only you, Joe. It's only you, while they're having sex. Now, whether it was the same time that she's saying all of those words, or whether it's another time that they're caught in a car having sex, I'm not sure. Again, the movie's not clear. But then they're having sex in a car. The gang of guys, all his quote friends, come and see them, and they scare them. They drag him out of the car. Both he and the girl are naked. They drag him out of the car, and then others chase her. And my feeling is that they gang raped her while they made him watch.
Okay.
That's what I saw from all of that.
Yep.
And just, if you haven't seen this movie and you just heard that description, you've heard what Patrick and Eric and I have said earlier about being dirty this whole goddamn movie. Now you understand why.
Yeah.
And so that's at the, you know, now I wasn't sure whether something happened to him as well. That was fuzzy.
That was my question.
I kind of got the feeling
it's possible that something did, that they were both raped.
All the other things that we had talked about.
Yes, it's very possible that they were both raped.
Yeah.
He for sure saw her. I think she went crazy from that. She had a moment where she just disengaged with reality. And the only thing she remembered was it's only you, Joe. And so that's why he got put into prison, because that's all she was saying. And that's what the cops thought. And they had no DNA. And there you go. Yeah.
She came out saying, Joe's the only one. Joe's the only one. So he actually went to jail.
He went to jail for the rapes of the other guys, even though his was the only consensual. Okay, whatever, whatever. Sad story. Maybe he did. I mean, and that would explain some things about his whole not wanting anybody to think that he's gay.
Absolutely.
And I can see that that would have happened. They did not, thank you God, the one thing they did not show that explicitly. So I don't have that image stuck in my head, but I have a lot of other images stuck in my head because of this movie. But that's what I feel. I feel that's what happened. And there you go. And there you go.
Yeah. But to me, it didn't make sense. I mean, I got what you got. And then my question was, I didn't know whether they were friends or not, whether they were like a gang.
Well, when they were following her, when she was just in her jeans, just walking down the street, he was in the middle of them.
Yeah.
And so I'm like, okay, he hangs out with
them.
Yeah. Fair.
He's the tall one who hangs out with them. Yeah. I mean, if he's in the middle.
But whether or not, you know, the plan was from the beginning, like, you seduce her and then we'll all have a good time with her.
No.
I don't think that was the plan.
Not at all. Look on his face when they drag him out of the car. He is not expecting that, and he is not wanting that.
And whether he was raped as well, because it looked like when he was, I mean, the position of him leaned over naked against the car looked like that was about to happen. It kind of, it made me think, okay, if that's like this huge sexually traumatic thing that you've just dealt with, whether he was raped or not, you know, being forced to observe a rape or that and being raped yourself, what on earth would then drive a person to say, I'm going to go to New York and have sex for money?
Well, I mean, there is the idea of control, that you take control back of your own body, and you're like, I'm going to do this, but it's going to be on my terms, and I'm going to be the one to facilitate it.
And I guess, and also because then you kind of cut off your emotional, you know, response.
But I also think we're giving a lot more depth to this than there was when the writer wrote it.
And there was also the prison time in between.
Yeah.
Yep. So that could have something could have happened.
I forgot about that. Yeah. I totally forgot about that.
So I agree with you. I think we are giving this movie or at least this little part of it way too much.
I think it was thrown in to be flashy and shocking and dramatic. And I think at the time it was enough. You can't do air quotes on a podcast. at the time it explained everything. People go, you see what happened there. And that explains everything. Well, no, it doesn't really. As you brought up one good logic thing there. Why would that make you want to do that?
But I feel like it's so purposefully vague. It wants you to come up with a story, and then it wants you to, you know, connect it somehow to what's going on.
What is the theory that says it's usually the simplest thing? Occam's razor. Why isn't it just not a scene they put in there because they could, because of the Hays Code?
Yeah, I think that's I think we saw a lot more of her body than we would have in another time. And
both of them.
Well, both of them, but we didn't see all his bits and bobs.
No. Even today you wouldn't see his bits and twigs.
Yeah.
But she
twigs, plural twigs.
Yeah, I didn't know where you were going. I didn't know where you were going.
Powers.
I thought maybe there were things I didn't know. I'm not going to judge you, Patrick. You do you, babe.
don't kink shame. Thank
you. But I mean, I agree. I think that some of this was, hey, look what we can do.
Yeah.
And look what I can do with a camera and editing. I felt a lot of that.
Yeah. So the next thing I kind of wanted to talk about was this kind of dual nature of this movie. On the one hand, and I want to get into this, this basically is kind of a love story between two men. I mean, it is the this relationship.
Two men
between,
I did not give a fuck about.
Well, granted, but Joe Buck and Ratso were kind of, this was the central relationship of the movie.
Yep.
On the other hand, what an incredibly homophobic movie. Oh my God. So I want to get into that. But first, let's talk about kind of Joe and Ratso. There are rumors. One of the guys who worked on the crew actually said afterwards that Schlesinger wanted to include an explicit sex scene between Joe Buck and Ratso Rizzo, which I got homoerotic, but in denial, like totally got that. I don't know that.
Well,
I
think that goes with what Patrick says, because he could, maybe. Because it was after it was post Hays Code, and hey, can we? And you know it, whether it fits the story or not.
Yeah, I mean, he already had the X rating, so
yeah,
maybe.
Yeah.
Would it have mattered?
I don't know whether. Yeah, whatever. Whatever.
Okay.
For me, it would have just been one more thing. Oh, look what I can do.
Yeah.
Exactly right. I don't think there's any reason to do that. I think that the best thing it has going for it is some of the ambiguity.
Yeah.
And that maybe they are, maybe they aren't. But also it is that day and age, which we saw several, you know, people who couldn't come out of the closet. They did acknowledge who they were, but they still, because of society and legality, they couldn't come out and be who they are. Yeah. Yep. And so we saw the bad parts of that. We didn't need why. My point would be, as a storyteller, why do you need that scene? And I don't think you do.
No,
and
I don't think you do either.
I'm glad that it wasn't clear.
I am too. I am too.
Yeah.
The first time that Joe and Ratso meet, though, as we said, it's pretty awful. I mean, Ratso bilks him out of money and sends him on a fool's errand to go see a potential pimp when, in fact, it's a religious fanatic. You know, and after that, and then when they run into each other again, Joe is predictably pissed off. He wants his money back. Rizzo's got 60 cents or odd cents in his pocket, and that's it.
And a bunch of other shit in his pocket.
Yeah. It was so gross. Yeah. Everything was gross. Everything is gross in this movie.
And he
puts
it on his plate.
God. dirty.
But then in the same conversation, Rizzo intuits the fact that Joe has no place to live. He kind of is looking at his dirty clothes and figuring they haven't been washed in a long time, and you don't look like.
Well, he had done that whole catch-up thing, remember, gotten that all over. He got to where he was even more disgusting than he was when he first got there.
And basically says, "I have a place you can stay," which I was like, "Where's that question coming from? Why would you, you know?" And then he accepts the offer, and then they start becoming, and I'm like, where did this come from?
I didn't believe it. And that's when I say two guys I didn't care about. I didn't really believe this relationship. I'm just going to throw that out there. I just didn't, it started
contrived.
It was contrived. That's exactly the word for it. And so
I feel like there was a real flaw in the writing in terms of, you know, why do they need each other? There's no reason.
They had a codependence, and I didn't know why.
Yeah,
that's exactly right. It's exactly
the
right.
Movie wanted
because Ratso had survived a long time before.
Plenty
this.
Well without Joe. He didn't need Joe to stay squatting in this place. And Joe certainly didn't.
Ratso brought everything to the party. Joe brought what? What did he bring?
The muscle.
The muscle and the ability to, you know, a few things that he could, you know, I mean,
I guess. It was just, it was very weird.
But by the time the movie's over, you know, Joe is willing to give up his dream. Now, it's a gross, squalid dream, but he had kind of achieved it. Like, he had another appointment with a rich housewife who was going to pay him for sex, which is the whole reason he came to New York. And he gave it up because Dustin Hoffman said, "I have to get to Florida before I die. I have, you know, tuberculosis or emphysema or whatever he had." I think it was tuberculosis.
It's movie death disease.
But
it's that vague thing,
and
that
I need to get down to where
everybody
it's warm,
dies from,
and so we need to go to Florida, and we need to go now. And he basically drops everything so he could save his friend. And of course, you know, like the feel good movie that it was, 10 minutes before they arrive in Miami, Dustin Hoffman is dead
in the backseat
after peeing himself.
Yeah,
and there were so many cliches about that whole moment. Anyway, when we got to suddenly we have a close up and John Voight is monologuing, I'm like, oh, Ratso's dying now. I mean, I knew it immediately when we got a close up of him talking, and I'm like saying how great it's going to be. I'm like, how many movies have we seen this in? When we pan across, guess who's dead?
Through the 69 lens, are we still getting that? I mean,
I don't know. I don't know if that was that's a good question.
People had done that since the 40s and the 50s. Okay. This was not new.
As we all know, part of watching a 1969 movie is looking at it through our 2019
and saying,
lens.
Is this a cliche? But no, yeah. I say that has happened before in the 50s and the 40s. I don't think that particular, there were some things that were new, but that was not. And, you know, some of the way that he did flashbacks, the sharp cuts and quick stuff, that was new filmmaking techniques, whatever.
No Dreamweaver.
But the idea of close up on somebody and then, you know, they're dead and you're like, oh God, okay.
Or something's happening to them off screen. And in this case, what else could happen? He was at death's door.
Yeah, he was just there in the bus. You can't go anywhere. I thought it was funny, the bus driver. So, you know, Ratso dies and Joe says, you know, my friend's dead. And like, well, nothing else we can do. We'll close his eyes and we'll go on to Miami.
That's true. I mean, they had 10 minutes to go. What are they going to do? Like, you know, let's get everyone off the bus, but let's get everyone off the bus when they're, I mean, in a way, but it was also like, that's probably what would happen.
Yeah.
Now let's talk about how incredibly homophobic this movie was. I knew it wasn't a good time. I mean, I knew that they made this movie before Stonewall and it came out, you know, the same time.
2 weeks before Stonewall.
But holy Christ, it was disgusting every single bit of it.
I mean, every gay person was
so
awful.
Jackie and was the guy, I mean, it was the guy in the bar who was, you know, probably on the gender spectrum, if we had language for that in 69.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, probably, I
mean, you did mention the blouse.
Yes, on his blouse.
And it was chartreuse,
but they didn't really have language for that as much as we do today. So he was just, you know, the F word is how we got to know him.
Well, that's all there was. That was only the F word. That was the only word we used. And then we showed these personalities. None of them that were nice. None of them were pleasant. And
well, actually, Bob Balaban, I will say, in his, because his role was this young.
But it was
young,
pathetic. If they weren't pleasant, they were pathetic.
Yes, absolutely. But I thought that Bob Balaban played this role with as much dignity as you possibly could, given what's in the
script. All of them did. No. I think they all played the roles and gave it as much, as you said, dignity and realism as they could. But it was written and directed and edited in a way that was just horribly uncomplimentary. Yeah.
And did anybody notice how much Bob looks like Rick Moranis?
No, but now that you say so, I can
glasses.
The entire time I was thinking, the first experience this guy's having is with the nerd that looks like Rick Moranis.
And Bob Balaban is a great actor. I mean, he's so
good.
He is
very good, which is what shocked me when I was like, oh my God, it's you.
But then Barnard Hughes plays the guy
earlier in your career.
Barnard Hughes was the one that I was just like, that whole scene. So here's what happens towards the end. When Joe decides he needs to get to Florida, he's already had sex with Brenda Vaccaro and has a date next Thursday with another rich housewife, and his dream is coming true, but he needs money now because Dustin Hoffman's got to get to Florida now. So he lets himself get picked up in an arcade by a really just pathetically drawn, you know, gay man who first has to call his mother before they hook up because, of course, gay men all are, you know, pathologically addicted to their mothers.
I'm telling you, this was written by somebody who did not know anything about anything he was writing about.
No.
And then basically, you know, when he gets down to it, John Voight cannot fulfill the deed and just beats the guy up and beats it and maybe even kills him.
Yeah,
you know, we don't know how we left him out cold and we have no idea. His false teeth go flying across the room, which was just one of those touches that I just thought, wow, insult to injury, literally.
I don't, by this time in the movie, I was over it.
Yeah.
I was over it. And I didn't want to hear the F word anymore. I didn't want to see where they lived anymore. I didn't want him to pick up any more men anymore. You know, it's like, you were an idiot. I don't like you, and you keep doing stupid things. You don't learn from anything you've ever done.
After one or two, you're not giving me the money. Why didn't you go to the escort service and say, "Give me a makeover, and I'll do whatever you need."
When they got to the escort service, and I thought, oh, he's going to go in.
Exactly.
But no, what do they do? No. They steal an address. It's like
they basically
he could have gone in.
Yes.
He. That's after they had washed his clothes and everything. He could have walked into there. Not Ratso. Ratso needed to stay on the street. Yep. But Joe Buck could have gone in there, and I bet she could have gotten him some work.
Yeah.
He's a big, dumb blonde.
Yeah. Put him in some different clothes.
Exactly. And, yeah. She would have made him over. We would have had that montage. And
then we would have had a very different movie.
And it might have been one that would have been entertaining to Stacey. But it also
would have been like a gender-reverse Pretty Woman. It would have been beautiful.
But it would have been...
He would have rescued her right back.
But here's what I'm going to say. Also, there would have been some kind of, I don't know if there was any kind of development or
so
any kind of evolution.
Question. Yeah. So that was my last question. The question is Joe too stupid to carry a movie? Cause he's so dumb, but
yes, he's too stupid to carry a movie.
I think so too. And is he any smarter at the end of the film?
Nope.
Did he learn anything?
Nope.
Has any of these experiences changed
Clearly
him
not.
Or taught him a thing?
He says he's going to get a real job. That's part of his monologuing to the dead rat. So is he's like, and he has this epiphany of, you know, maybe I'll get a job where, you know, it's a decent job where they pay me for what. And I'm like, oh my God, this is the first time that you've heard this. You've been in the military. You've been in prison. You have worked on the street for however many weeks and all of this. And this is the first time that it occurred to you to get a non-street hustling job. You're an idiot. And now you're Miami's problem.
Yeah. Which, two things. One, I think it might have changed him a little bit emotionally, but not psychologically to the point where he was going to clean up his act and do all the things that you just suggested. And now I'm kind of wondering about the timeline of before the movie, because we've talked, you know, that military service and the prison stint, which came first? I would hope that
I feel like the prison came first, but would they let you into the military after the prison thing?
Exactly. In the draft, the draft just started in 69. So this wouldn't have been, he wouldn't have been drafted.
He wasn't drafted. I think he volunteered.
I don't think they would have drafted a
felon.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I think
it would have happened after.
My point, bringing that back up, is I don't think, because of all those previous experiences, that the bus ride to Miami, and I'm making gestures with my fingers, which doesn't work on a podcast, air quotes, I don't think it changed him at all in the ways that you were saying. Mm-hmm. But I think maybe there might be some emotional change. Like he got some kind of emotional fulfillment, emotional attachment to Ratso during that.
Yeah, he gave up his dream to save his friend. Yes. I mean, that to me, that happened. So I don't know whether that's supposed to be redemptive or not, but like, you know, what's his reward? He ends up next to a dead body in a bus to Miami. Like,
what would be redemptive about it?
Well, I mean, he's a better person. He's a better person than he used to be.
He
gave up his,
I mean, I guess
he wasn't a bad person.
He wasn't a bad person. He was always, and he's from Texas, and he was proud of that. And, you know, honor and loyalty, that's a thing.
He was a meh person.
He was very mad. He was very mad.
Okay, so a little bit of trivia before we play our game. Other people who were interested in the role of Joe Buck, some of them screen tested. One was even offered the role, but then turned it down because of scheduling. He was actually going to do it. Warren Beatty was up for Joe Buck. And this was around. This is around.
Is it before
Bonnie
or after
Clyde.
Shampoo?
It was before Shampoo.
Okay.
Post Bonnie and Clyde. Okay. Young, hot Warren Beatty.
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
I could see it. Before he was a star, you know who screen tested for this? Harrison Ford.
Totally would have changed the Star Wars canon.
It probably would have changed the Midnight Cowboy canon as well. I mean, it would have changed. That would have been a different movie. That would have been a very different movie.
I think it would have been
and
a
his career
movie.
Would have been a really
very different direction. I mean, let's just say he would have given a good performance.
Performance. I'm really
like
glad he didn't
picture,
do it.
Blah, blah, blah.
I'm really glad he didn't do it, though.
Yeah. Because he became kind of known. He had a really great cameo in American Graffiti right before Star Wars. And that was, what, 76?
Star Wars was 76.
Star Wars was 76. This would have been like 74, 75.
Yeah.
Okay. So this was like a good 5 years before. He was mostly working crew in Hollywood, but occasionally screen testing for things. Who had the role and then turned it down because of scheduling? Lee Majors. The $6 million man was going to be Joe.
Now, see, of all of those, now, Harrison wasn't a star yet. Warren Beatty had done stuff. But Lee Majors, he needed the gig.
Yeah.
He wasn't anything yet. He was just a upcoming struggling actor. Yep. So that would have been you talk about changing the course of his career. It very well could have. Yeah. Depending on how well he did.
Yeah.
I would be interested to see how well he did.
John Voight got an Oscar nomination for what he did. I can imagine that Harrison Ford and Lee Majors would have done just as well, if not better.
Lee would have done it just as well, if not better. Harrison would for sure have done better. But yeah, interesting.
Whether he knew how to act yet was a question mark.
Yeah, I don't know. We don't know.
Did you really need it for this movie?
Well, clearly not, because we watched John Voight just kind of
who got an Oscar nomination
zombie
for doing
it.
What he did. Yeah.
For being a brick theater.
And I really think Joe Buck was just so badly written. I mean, to me, that
was very poorly written. No, I 100% with you. But there were moments that could have been more. And that was on the actor and director. Yeah.
So here's another thing. Robert Blake was offered the role of Ratso Rizzo, but turned it down.
He could have kicked its ass. I'll be honest with you. Robert Blake back in the day could have totally done that role.
Yeah.
I totally get why he turned it down.
Yeah, I do too. To me, the smartest person involved with this entire thing was Dustin Hoffman.
I agree.
Because I'm walking here is what most people still remember from this movie.
And that was an ad-lib.
A total ad-lib. Because a car literally almost... not mowed him down, and he just stayed in character, which is the method thing to do. You know, that's a great showbiz story.
1969.
But he was the one who had the most to gain and actually got a lot from it. He got another Oscar nomination, but it really did say the two things that people knew him for at this moment were Midnight Cowboy and The Graduate. You can't get much further apart.
No,
but also critically acclaimed.
Yes.
I mean, it was very, very smart. He had, but I think that for it to be smart, he needed to have The Graduate in his pocket. That he needed to have something where he was the leading guy, not this gross thing. If this had been his first one, I think he might have had a different trajectory.
He would have been the ingenieur.
Yeah. Yeah. No, but that's, he was so at the perfect place
now,
in his career to
after
do this.
After this, he's now considered an actor, which is what he wanted in.
And the idea is, he can do anything.
Yes,
like he's another Meryl, know, and right around the corner was Kramer versus Kramer. Yeah. Well, no, that was a decade later.
Yep.
Okay, so we're going to play a little game. The game is, aren't you thrilled that we're going to make another movie in the Midnight Cowboy franchise? And we're going to do to sequel or not to prequel. So you could either do a movie that comes before, a movie that comes after, a movie that is weirdly, coinciding with, but about, take a little character and give them a movie, do a spinoff, whatever
like
you want to do.
Rogue One.
Yeah.
That was a great movie.
Rogue One was a really good movie.
I really liked it.
Fill in the gap movie.
It was wonderful. It really was. It was very clever. So. Oh, but let's get back to this one, Patrick. Okay. We're not talking about
are we? I'm trying to avoid this because I don't know what I would do, but...
Burn the celluloid, wouldn't you, of the original?
I wouldn't burn it. I would put it in a warehouse somewhere where it would degrade on its own. One of the things that struck me was the outfit that Joe Buck changes into during the end of the
Florida
Miami
tourist
trip.
Grandfather, you
is
mean?
Almost the same exact outfit that Robin Williams wears in The Birdcage, and they're in Miami. So my assumption is just the sequel is Birdcage. But
Robin Williams was Joe Buck.
Oh my God. If only Nathan Lane had been in this. If only.
I'll tell you, or somebody like Nathan Lane. If I were to choose something, the obvious is to do a backstory on Ratso to see how he got where he was. And we had talked about that in the parking lot. But I think it would be kind of fun to explore one of the two women that were in the movie. Why was Brenda Vaccaro where she was, and why is she doing what she was doing? And Cass. I mean, it's like that would be interesting. I want to know more about Morty. Why is she leaving Morty or sleeping around on Morty? But I think if I were to choose something, I would go off.
You'd do a Rogue One. Mm-hmm. You'd go Rogue.
Go Rogue One.
He'd go Rogue
I'd
One.
I'd go Rogue One. Totally go Rogue One on that.
Okay.
How about you?
I said sequel. Just for giggles, because I wouldn't do any of it. But if I had to, gun to my head, sequel. Because I would see, okay, so now he's in Miami. Now what? Are you going, is Joe going to do the same? Is he going to try to get that job? And if he tries to get the job, will he be successful? Or is he going to fall back and say, well, I do know I can do sex, so let me try on the Miami people. Or did he then, you know, become a mentor and open his own hustler bordello or I don't know. That would, you know, that Miami. Would be in Miami. And, you know, that's where I would want to see, again, it goes to your question. Did he learn from any of this? Is he too stupid? We've all said that we think he would be, but the sequel would be, you know, confirming whether he is too stupid. And so here's another dumb movie. Or no, you know, look at him. He actually is a savant and he got really smart and he's a millionaire in Miami and ends up as a villain on Miami Vice.
Is your sequel a comedy or a drama? Because I kind of think the way you're describing it, if he didn't learn anything and he was still the bumbling idiot,
it's a drama. It's like a motherfucker.
Oh, really?
Just kind of bumbles through life.
No, I mean, you know. Here's the thing. If I had anything to do with anything, there would have to be some more comedic moments to it. Having said that, I don't think there is any comedy in Joe. I think Joe, when, you know, so my sequel
everything
is,
would happen
is fantasy.
To him, even if it were a comedy.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. He's not the leading man in his own story, which is weird.
Yep. And I went to the prequel place. I just wanted to know more about Grandma. I'm just gonna set the whole Grandma Buck, you know, and kind of this woman who is, you know, and I would kind of like I'd want to show tell the story of the trampy grandma from her perspective.
Yeah,
she's a single woman. I don't know what happened to her daughter, but this kid gets dropped off on her, you know, on her front porch, and she's still trying to, like, you know, find a guy and take care of this kid and just kind of do the best she can. And maybe it's not very good,
you know,
but I think that could be interesting.
That just reminded me of, we talked about Forrest Gump and we're talking, I think we did sequel prequel at that one. And we talked about the prequel being Mama.
Yep.
And this is kind of a very similar character to Mama Gump. And that you want to go, okay, how did you get here? How did, you know, clearly you're a survivor, but how did you get here? And why is your grandson so stupid?
It's just like Forrest Gump in that way, actually.
It sounds like we're writing Sordid Lives meets Tu Wong Fu.
Well, Joe doesn't have the excuse of having autism. He's just dumb. You know, I don't have a problem with Forrest.
Okay, so this is the most, you know, I feel is a this, shock coming on. Yeah. We're going to play Skip, Rent, or Buy. Skip means don't see this movie, don't bother, it's trash. Rent means...
Look how Patrick's looking like he's thinking. Really?
I'm thinking.
Rent means you should see this movie once, and rent could mean you should see this movie once because it's an important moment in film history, or it's actually something that you would enjoy. Buy means you should watch this movie several times because there's so much to offer.
You'll get something out of it different every time.
Try all the venereal diseases. They all offer something new and special.
Is it bean soup or is that rat turd? I don't know.
I just assumed it was Dinty Moore.
Okay. Yeah. Stacey, we're going to start with you.
Thank you.
Really?
Yeah, because I love a surprise ending.
I'm going to say Buy and watch it every day. That's a surprise. Skip this bitch. This is awful. This is awful. I don't get it. And here's the thing. You know, we talk about film history and I am not one to eschew that. I think it's great to look at where we've been and how film has developed. Certainly in the 20th century, it was this new thing in the aughts, you know, 100 years ago, it was so new and they were still figuring out there wasn't even sound yet 100 years ago. And we've come so far and in the 60s and 70s, there were still a lot of technical stuff going on. As you said, the Hays Code happened for a while. Then it was over and we see a lot of these movies. 1969, you know, I'll be honest, there were a lot of movies that came in and out in 1969. And some of them were good. I will say that of the ones that we watched, there weren't a lot that I liked that much, quite frankly, of the six that we pulled out. But it's not that I went into it knowing that. I thought because they were historically relevant, I would very much possibly like them. My problem with some of them is that they are so steeped in that particular era that they can't pull themselves out and be any kind of timeless. And while this was the first X-rated movie to ever get an Oscar, and then of course it's an R-rated now, and it probably, there are some techniques in it that are, you know, very hip and happening back in the day. And so it may have even developed some things editorial, editing wise. God, that's not right. Is that a word? Probably not. Anyway, point being, I will say this. Did Dustin Hoffman do a good job? He sure did. Is Brenda Vaccaro cute as a button? But this is not a movie, in my opinion, that lives up to it. And I read, so Roger Ebert wrote a review. He watched it back when it came out, mm-hmm. but then he watched it again in the 90s. This is pre 9/11, which I also, it's pre 21st century. And I think that's important too, because it's pre internet, it's pre social media, it's pre all of that stuff, Me Too and all of that stuff. But it was the 90s. So it was post a lot of other stuff that mm-hmm. happened between 69.
Times Square had been cleaned up.
Correct. But he watched it again and didn't like it as much as he liked it back in the 60s. And when he watched it, when it first came out, and he said, it's not timeless. He said there are too many things wrong with it to make it. He said it doesn't live. It doesn't survive past that time. And I agreed with him, and I went, that's exactly the problem with, in my opinion. So I say to you, it is not going to necessarily historically give you, there are other movies that will give you this historical stuff. I say it's a pass, because I, you know, the shower I took afterwards was so hot.
The best part of the movie.
And then not only that, you know what I had to do right after? I actually literally put on one of my British mysteries, because I had to get that taste out of my mouth. It was just, my brain was dirty.
I watched an episode of Mad About You. So
exactly. Yeah. You had just to get it out.
Senseless comedy, funny
but,
things.
But yeah, to take you to a different place. It was awful. Anyway, okay. Skip.
Although it didn't take me to a different place. It just took me the same place 25 years later.
It took you a different place.
Yeah. Patrick.
So I have been looking forward. When you sent me the list of the movies that you wanted me to be part of, I was really excited because this was on it. It was a movie that I had not seen. Now I'm going to surprise myself, and I'm going to say I would skip it. If I knew what I know now, and having actually listened to our discussion on the podcast later, I would probably say, don't bother. It has some things, like Stacey said, cinematically, there are probably some very important pieces, the cutaways, the flashbacks, the flashy things that were happening. But
other movies were doing it too.
Right. But it does not hold up for 2019. It is very homophobic. It is a very weak plot. It is, you know, other than Dustin Hoffman, the three majors that we've talked about, there's nothing exciting about John Voight. And I just could not say to one of my friends.
And there are other movies that all of those actors have been in that will give you a really true testament to what they can do. Absolutely. You don't have to watch this movie to get good performances from some of those other people.
Right. And it,
John Voight was arguably a lot better in.
Oh, he's done so much better in other things.
Coming Home was
If I were to pick, you know, the three of Dustin Hoffman's earliest films, like Graduate, this one, and say Kramer versus Kramer, I would say skip this one. The other two are so much better.
Yeah.
And I felt like you did. I felt so dirty when it was over.
Yeah.
And I made the mistake of watching the two movies that I was supposed to watch back to back. And that was a mistake. This one second.
Yeah.
I should have watched this one first and used the second one as a palate cleaner. But
yeah, I'm a skip on this one too. You know, it's one of those that
surprise ending.
Well, that I usually really because I usually
you always say Rent.
I would have said
your worst case scenario is usually Rent, because you'll say Rent this one time, then you've seen it and you never have to watch it again. Yeah. At least you have it in your pocket. I don't know that I've ever seen you say skip.
I skipped on The Blind Side because for the same reasons this one. I think this is a damaging movie. Like, I think this movie makes you worse. You know,
I mean, it makes you a worse person.
Yes, I think this movie. I mean, you know,
I think it makes you feel worse.
It makes you feel worse, and I think that, and you know, not.
If you're believing any of it, then yes, it will make you a worse person.
If you walk in with no kind of, you know, preconceived notions about a lot of things in the world, but I'm saying specifically as a gay man, this is a bad movie.
This is just,
you know, and so there's a lot that's not great about it. But it's the depiction of my community in particular that I just kind of looked at this and went, oh, my, oh no, like, please don't watch this. Like, and you please do,
and,
don't.
And we had a hint at the very beginning when the F word is dropped about so 15 times in
it's like
in
orgy from five. Tender yeah. Girl.
5 minutes. And I was just like, oh, this is what we're doing. Yeah, oh, yeah. OK.
Yeah.
And it just it got worse.
The movie won't make you worse, but this movie makes the world a worse place. Like, it's just there's no good reason to sit and watch it. I mean, no. It's just what there's not much to
there's
recommend.
There's nothing
it.
You can pull from it. That's what I think.
I think you can read that this was the first X-rated movie to ever win a Best Picture, and that piece of trivia is going to get you as far as you don't need to watch the movie beyond that.
Just like, do you think the release date had anything to do with Stonewall? Just as a gay man, the release date, it's literally 2 weeks before Stonewall happened. Do you think that this
might have been
a contributing factor?
No, listen, I think that if, you know, if any pop culture moment did, the one that everyone kind of points to is that Judy Garland died the day before and all the queens were in mourning. I don't think so either. I think that it was basically, you know, I think the queens were all sitting around going, Judy died. And then they were raided again and finally just said, you know what?
Okay,
we're done. Yeah. I think it was really to do with the more lived experience of those people in that bar than it was this movie. I think this was just...
No, I'm not saying this movie caused it, but this was a mitigating factor.
Well,
the zeitgeist that is depicted in this movie absolutely was one of the people were sick and tired of being dehumanized.
Toward that is that we watched Boys in the Band last year. Yeah. And of these two movies that are pre Stonewall, if you know, you get the same kind of information as with regard to how hard it was to be certainly specifically a gay man in that time from the Boys in the Band in a way that is much more palatable than this.
And much more human.
And much more realistic, quite frankly. You know, so I think that if you need a movie that is, well, you know, that's the way things were, don't go to this.
No.
Go to something like Boys in the Band or something else. This, to me, as I said, it felt like from the beginning to end on every level, including gay men life in America, it was written by someone who didn't know Jack. They'd never been to the party. They didn't know gay men in America. They hadn't been to New York City ever. They weren't a businessman in New York because you don't die on the sidewalk. I mean, but and maybe they had never been on a bus to Miami because we really experienced the hell out of that. But I mean, it just, it felt like it was written by someone who didn't know. Yeah. And
if you want to know how badly gay men can be depicted on film, watch The Celluloid Closet, because at least that's interesting and educational. Yeah. Okay. And Lily Tomlin narrates it, and that's lovely. This is just going to depress you. I mean, you don't need to experience it just to know how bad it was. No, so really. Anyway, we're beating this.
But yeah.
We're beating this dead Dustin Hoffman
horse,
you know, to the ground. This is The Rewind Project. I'm Eric.
I'm Stacey. And
I'm Patrick.
Yay.
And we'll see you next time. The next suite of episodes explore the films of 1944.
How many years ago is that?
75.
Damn.
75 years ago. Till then, be kind. Rewind.
You've been listening to The Rewind Project. You can find us on most podcast listening forums, including iTunes, Radio Public, Stitcher, and Google Play. And don't forget to subscribe and rate us. It helps a lot. Thanks for listening. Be kind, rewind.